Thank you very much, Hans. Good morning, everyone. It is a pleasure being here. And the topic of the first session is related to earlier diagnosis of Gaucher disease. So we have two additional panelists who will give the perspective of the hematologists and the non-hematologists. And I will try to set the stage where we are today. This is my disclosure. And this is another group picture that I think with Professor Hans Ernst just reminded us of a meeting that took place in Amsterdam. And it is indeed one of those opportunities where the patients and doctors, scientists are benefiting from collaboration with the industry. You know, there are a lot of concerns sometimes about interaction between academia and industry, but there are many, many, many good things that that happen. And what you see here is a group picture that was taken last month from an incentive that started with Shire, Dr. Zoya Panolo, where the concept of how to diagnose patients at an earlier stage, we all know and we'll talk about it, that patients with rare diseases, multi-system diseases are classically being delayed in the diagnosis, and sometimes that delay makes the whole difference for the life. So we have, you can see, a very large group of people that many of you are familiar with, and this actually also set the stage for this session of today. So I think it's really nice. Also, since my talk is a kind of an introduction, some of you, maybe many of you, have seen some of my slides before of that particular talk. So I go back now for the Jewish background. And in our Jewish tradition, there is a saying that he who learns the Bible and does not repeat it is like the one who sows and does not reap. So there is actually a value of seeing the same thing repeatedly from the educational standpoint. So I will not really apologize about that. And the topics I would like to cover would have to do with the time to diagnosis. Even when the patient with Gaucher disease present in the most typical, if we can talk about a typical feature of the disease, that one of its hallmark is the great phenotypic heterogeneity, but let's talk about type 1 patient with a big spleen and thrombocytopenia and bone pain. Even the patient with a more typical phenotype is likely to be misdiagnosed because in his environment, it's a very rare disease. And often rare diseases are manifested by common symptoms. So we'll talk about this time to diagnosis. Things are becoming all the more complicated when we are facing with the change of the phenotype. And there are many reasons for that. Even if we are very successful in making an earlier diagnosis, then we will see the patient maybe at an early stage, maybe even presymptomatic, which also has its complexities. Patients with Gaucher, and we've already heard about the relation between Gaucher disease, even being a carrier of Gaucher disease, and Parkinson. Many times, it is the other disorder that is more common in patients with Gaucher disease than in the general population that will bring the patient to the physician. So the diagnosis can follow actually the occurrence of not the metabolic disease. So we'll ask a little bit about the means of diagnosis. We will have more about biomarkers in the tomorrow, and a little bit about the future. So the future should allow us to diagnose earlier, but also to know what to do with that. Now, this is one of the slides that many of you have seen before. It's coming from a paper that was led by Professor Pamistri, and this is about the delayed diagnosis of a typical classic case of Gaucher disease. And a group of senior physicians from several countries that are listed at the footnote here were asked what comes to their mind in the differential diagnosis when they need to consider the diagnosis of a 42-year-old man with anemia, thrombocytopenia, organomegaly, and either acute or chronic bone pain. Which possible condition come to mind? And only 20% of these senior hematologist included Gaucher disease in the differential diagnosis. Now, we don't need to do a major multinational survey of hematologists, and I can show you an example. I'm very well aware that the majority of the text is in Hebrew, because this is actually a photocopy of a discharge letter from a patient, 30-year-old, who came to Shaarei Tzedek, to the emergency room, at the early stage of pregnancy because of fever. She had ended up having a massive bilateral pneumonia, was hospitalized in the Department of Medicine in my hospital, where we have the, well, by patient number, it's the world's largest clinic for Gaucher disease. So Gaucher clinic appears every list of departments. You go to the elevator, you go to the corridor, everybody knows about Gaucher disease. We are doing at least one general ground round for the past more than 20 years. We have lectures within the departments. And in the Department of Medicine comes a typical case of an Ashkenazi Jewish woman with splenomegaly, thrombocytopenia, and osteonecrosis. So she tells them that as a child she suffered from leg calves, Perthes disease. But Perthes disease, when you don't know the diagnosis, it's Perthes disease. If it's somebody with Gaucher disease, it's avascular necrosis, reflecting a severe form of Gaucher disease. But she is getting very good care for the pneumonia and is released with the diagnosis of pancytopenia splenomegaly for investigation. And this was in 2010. And she came to our clinic only 2 years later when finally this investigation took place. So misdiagnosis of even common, typical feature of a disease that in the Ashkenazi Jewish is not that rare. 1 out of 850 is affected with Gaucher disease is a challenge. And it by itself justifies repeating ourselves trying to educate our audience. And this is what we want to prevent. A patient may be identified, whether a child or an adult, I show you, with massive organomegaly, thrombocytopenia. As a child, it can be associated with a failure to grow, mainly the height. But as long as there are not irreversible skeletal complications, even a delayed beginning of treatment may reverse the picture. Gaucher disease is not like the other LSDs. But if the patient is presented already with osteonecrosis, then his disability will remain forever. So this is basically why it is so important to diagnose on time. And I already mentioned that many of the rare diseases are manifested by common symptoms. Think about Fabry disease, proteinuria. Proteinuria can be such a common finding, so it really requires a lot of awareness in order to consider also the less common disorders. So what's common is common. We cannot criticize the physician not making the diagnosis, especially if he or she are a general practitioner someplace in Bangladesh, who knows. But as I say, patients may present with atypical feature, and then it is much more difficult to diagnose, and then there are coexistence of other diseases, whether they are related or not related to the metabolic diseases, and it makes the challenge, as I said, it's a real challenge. In this slide, there is a list of all kind of atypical manifestations, and most of you know, but there could be liver cirrhosis, repeated bacterial infection. Patient presented only with isolated vertebral compression and some osteoporosis, quite non-specific. We are dealing with the accumulation of masses of Gaucher cells that behave like a tumor, usually adjacent to the bones, and mesenteric lymphadenopathy. All of these are Gaucher features. And just a couple of examples is it's an atypical case, but of patients who develop massive calcifications of the aortic and mitral valve. When we first see the patient, we thought he had Gaucher disease and rheumatic heart disease. But when we later on, we found that all his siblings, fortunately for us, he came from a large family. So all the siblings who were homozygous for the same mutation, who had Gaucher disease, also developed these terrible calcifications on the heart valve and great arteries. And the non-Gaucher siblings, whether they were carriers or non-carriers, never had any problems. And because other reports were found in the literature, In fact, this atypical rare variant that Prime Minister in a commentary to our Lancet paper suggested to call it type 3C, type 3 because they do have abnormal eye movement, and C rather than A and B because type A have a lot of neurological problems with minimal visceral disease. Type 3B is the other way around, massive visceral disease with minimal neurological feature. This variant did not have not visceral disease, nor massive, not neurological, not massive visceral disease, but they all share this progressive calcified valves, and it's basically a fatal disease. The kids die at the age of between 10 and 20, the majority of them, even if they undergo successful valve surgery. So in fact, of the, and Professor Ertz has already mentioned the imperfect genotype-phenotype correlation, this variant may be the one with the closest ability to predict the phenotype based on the genotype. Fortunately, it is very rare, and the majority of the patients live in three villages near the town of Jenin. I think Professor Pastores, whom you'll hear later today, once was consulted about a patient from Cleveland with that typical type 3C, D49H homozygous, and he gave them some advice, and then I asked him where this patient is coming from, and the answer was that he was coming from Kuwait, but his family came from the same village. So it is a really interesting thing. Unfortunately, we have not been able to offer a population screening for that terrible illness in an area where there's a high degree of consanguinity. We were collaborating with Dr. Vinot from the University of Ottawa in Canada, and we were able to demonstrate the, not just the massive infiltration of inflammatory cells and calcification, but also to demonstrate that there was indeed a Gaucher cell existent by CD68, because some people questions whether it is really a feature of Gaucher even after we published. And you can see here the calcification of the aortic arch, very bad disease. And again, the fact that other case reports appear in the literature help us to understand that it's really a feature of the metabolic disease. And this, I think, is the same patient that Greg Pastores was consulted. Unfortunately, the paper ends with the patient being stable 20 months after operation, but a couple of weeks after the publication, the patient actually died. Reminding me the statement of Sheila Sherlock that good results are likely to be reported, and the literature is indeed a bit biased to favorable outcome. There is another example of a rare complication, and this is iloepsoas hematoma. I will not get to a lot of details, it's an old paper, but a Russian patient was referred to us with inability to walk. She came on a wheelchair. She did have severe Gaucher disease, she was splenectomized, she had bilateral osteonecrosis, but the reason she could not walk had to do with the development of iloepsoas hematoma. Okay, developing unusual sites of a bleeding phenomenon in patients with bleeding disorder could be a coincidence or not. But again, with the appearance of the paper in the literature of additional cases, this had at least a happy end, that following the drainage of the hematoma, she could immediately walk and felt much better. She was placed on enzo-replacement therapy, and by now she's happily married with two kids. And as I said, the publication of other cases allow us to conclude that iloepsoas hematoma is indeed an atypical features may be representing complication of the course of Gaucher disease. Well, hepatocellular carcinoma is even more challenging. It could be an example for rare complication of Gaucher disease because especially patients who underwent splenectomy in the past, in the pre-ERT era, some of them developed cirrhosis. Not all of them, the minority of them developed cirrhosis. But once you develop cirrhosis, then it may lead to hepatocellular carcinoma. I mentioned splenectomy. Many patients receive blood products during the course of splenectomy before the blood banks were screening for hepatitis C, for example. And we have many patients with hepatitis C and or hepatitis B and Gaucher. So hepatocellular carcinoma could be viewed as a complication of the treatment, of the transfusion that they used to receive. But at the same time, with the growing realization that patients with Gaucher disease do have a higher prevalence of some of the malignant disorders, it could be that a patient with Gaucher without cirrhosis and without hepatitis will develop hepatocellular carcinoma. And again, because overall it is rare, but when you take together different cases, you realize that the frequency, albeit very small, of hepatocellular carcinoma in patients with Gaucher is manifold higher than in the general population. We saw one case of a splenectomized young woman who did not have hepatitis, but she was cirrhotic. And you can see here what the pathologists call the beautiful case of hepatocellular carcinoma. I usually don't like the term beautiful for malignancies, but it is a good picture where you can see the cirrhosis, the Gaucher cell infiltration, and the hepatocellular carcinoma all on the same slides. And this was published in a chapter on a book on metabolic aspect of chronic liver diseases several years ago. So when I want to introduce you the concept of associated diseases versus comorbidities. So originally, we adopted the term associated diseases for those different diseases that presented greater prevalence in patients with Gaucher disease and distinct it from comorbidities, which could be any disorder that can happen to anybody, regardless of whether or not they have metabolic disease, but they may impact on each other. We talked a lot about it because it is an important topic, and the reason it has not been published yet is that we still debate about nomenclature, about which disease belongs to which category. Recently, also with the help of Professor Carla Holak, we let her review the draft and think we prefer now to talk about Gaucher-related versus Gaucher-unrelated diseases. And it is important to keep in mind that even though disorders that are not more prevalent in patients with Gaucher, but when they occur in patients with Gaucher disease, they may impact it on Gaucher-specific therapies and vice versa. So I'll give you some examples. Let me begin with pregnancy. And I know pregnancy is not a disease, but it is a good example for a medical condition, physiological condition, that has nothing to do with the fact that you have Gaucher disease or not. Actually, when I consult ultra-Orthodox Jews, you know, they live with arranged marriages. When the kids become like 18, the parents of both kids are looking for a matchmaking. And one of the key concerns would be about pregnancy. So we know that pregnancy in patients with Gaucher, especially in a symptomatic patient who does not receive treatment, may be associated with a greater risk of bleeding during the course of the pregnancy or afterward. Some patients, when they became pregnant, they develop bone crisis, severe bone pains. And in a similar to some of the patients with autoimmune diseases like lupus, for example, some of the patients, when they are pregnant, they feel better. Some of them feel worse. So even though the pregnancy itself has nothing to do with the metabolic disease, they have mutual information. And of course, if we have different causes for bleeding tendency, and you also have low platelet count and or dysfunction of the platelets, then you are more likely to develop a bleeding sequela, which will make the situation worse. We have a patient with incidental finding of a brain cavernoma, and she's very concerned about the risk of bleeding because she has also Gaucher disease and something that may one day bleed. To consider a comorbidity, I have for you three tips. Two of them were included in a review that we published a long time ago in The Lancet, and one is a new one. So when the hemoglobin level is significantly lower than the platelet count, think about another cause for the anemia. When a patient with hepatosplenomegaly has massive enlargement of the liver, but only minimal enlargement of the spleen, think about another comorbidity affecting primarily the liver. And the third tip, any time the patient does not respond to ERT, or he started with respond well and all of a sudden he deteriorates, consider a significant comorbidity. So here is an example of a patient who presented with 6 g% of hemoglobin and 70,000 platelets. We'll come back to her later this day. And she was found to have AML. And the other patient with a big liver and not so big spleen was eventually found to have autoimmune hepatitis. So I already mentioned multiple myeloma. And the list of cancer when it was published 10 years ago may need to be updated. As we get more information, we learn more. We know the data that come from the registry, and these are like as good as it gets, but it still tends to suffer from some lack of underreporting. Multiple myeloma by far is a disorder that common in patients with Gaucher may has to do with elevated IL-6 or not. We believe that hepatocellular carcinoma belongs to that list, but the good news for the patient, however, is that there are some malignancies like breast cancer, prostate, that may be less prevalent in patients with Gaucher compared to the general population, so God gave us some balance here. And we've already mentioned Gaucher disease and Parkinson, and really happy that we have in the crowd Professor Michael Schlossmacher, who is a big leader today in the research of the relation between Parkinson and not just Gaucher, but genetic risk factors. And I think this is really an amazing story, how something that started with a case report, with just a question in the audience by a physician asking me, when I was hosting, by the way, Ernie Beutler in Israel in the early 90s, she said, I have two patients with Gaucher and both of them has Parkinson. Do you think they are related? This was the beginning of a story. Of course, my answer at the time was, I think it's a coincidence, and Parkinson is common, and Gaucher disease is not rare in Ashkenazi Jews, but when more and more cases started to pile together, it led to a first report of the possibility of having Gaucher disease and Parkinson, maybe some association, and today we know so much about the high prevalence of GBA carriers in patients with Parkinson, and I'm sure maybe in the next GES meeting we will dedicate the session, because it's a growing story. So how to diagnose the patient? The classic diagnosis and the gold standard is still demonstrating the low enzymatic activity of the glucocerebrosidase. However, until many years, several years ago, the reason that the majority of the patient did not have enzymatic diagnosis at presentation was that the test was not readily available, and only referral centers used to offer the test. Ernie Beutler published editorial in 1990 about the misuse of marrow examination in the diagnosis of Gaucher disease, and it still happens. Anyway, with the development of the technique of a dry blood spot, originally reported by Chamoles, and this guy from Argentina actually was even unable to present his contribution in scientific meetings, and Bruno Bembi, in another historical meeting, allowed him to have a poster. But the ability to use dry blood spot, which is so simple, 5 drops of blood on a filter paper, it can be dried and shipped to whatever referral center, referral lab, we can generate today not just the enzymatic activity, but also the DNA analysis and identification of biomarker, so we can diagnose somebody who lives in Paraguay when the filter paper is sent to Argentina to Chamoles lab. Actually, unfortunately, he died at a young age, and the referral lab is named for him. Okay, molecular diagnosis allow us to detect carriers, and we will hear a lot about biomarkers, and one of the important biomarkers was also published in Blood several years ago by the group of Professor Hans Hertz, and this has to do with the glucose fingosine, or also for some reason it's called lyso-GB1, and this seems to be a very sensitive and specific biomarker. Future strategies will be discussed by my panelists that are coming right after me, but the story, if you want to improve the diagnosis and to prevent irreversible complications by the time that we assess the patient, we really need a great awareness. Awareness can be generated by large-scale meetings, by small meetings, by talks within the departments in my hospital so they will not miss another case, by all kinds of public activities, like October is the Gaucher Awareness Month. There are patient organization, website, everything that will increase the likelihood that the physician will include Gaucher disease in the differential diagnosis of all those typical findings like enlarged spleen, bone pain, etc., will benefit patients. And if we use dry blood spots, we can start to do large scale screening. It is commonly done in the Jewish community, but as a pre-marital or prenatal. I believe that with advanced technology, we will see neonatal screening, and this will increase the challenges. So I see that my last slide is not here, but my thank you slide had some tulips. Being in Amsterdam in the season of the tulips, I wanted to show you that we do have tulips in Israel growing in the desert as wildflowers. So thank you for your attention.